Hello, and this is the fourth review for the AP exam. This section is called Nationalism, and it really starts with the election of 1824. In the election of 1824, there are four candidates: Andrew Jackson, John Quincy Adams, William Crawford, and Henry Clay. Andrew Jackson is from Tennessee, John Quincy Adams is from Massachusetts, William Crawford is from Georgia, and Henry Clay is from Kentucky. In this election, there's no clear winner. Nobody gets the majority, so it actually goes to the House of Representatives to decide this race. William Crawford has a stroke, and he has to bow out of the election, which then leads to the last two, or to the main two candidates, Andrew Jackson and John Quincy Adams, to have a runoff in the House of Representatives. It goes to vote after vote after vote after vote. Finally, John Quincy Adams gets Henry Clay, who's the Speaker of the House, to sway enough votes his way for him to win, for John Quincy Adams to win by one of the narrowest margins in any election in the United States. Of course, Andrew Jackson is furious about this. He immediately calls this a corrupt bargain, and because of this, Andrew Jackson is going to drop out of the Senate and for the next year, 4 years, plot against John Quincy Adams. Now, part of this bargain, part of this deal between John Quincy Adams and Henry Clay, is that John Quincy Adams agreed to make Henry Clay the Secretary of State in the Adams presidency. Remember what the importance was with Secretary of State was that at the time it looked like whoever was Secretary of State was next in line then to be President of the United States. Jackson calls this election the corrupt bargain and spends the next 4 years campaigning against John Quincy Adams. Land ownership and democracy. Because of the election of 24, we eliminate the land requirement for voting, we eliminate the land requirement for running for office, and we also make universal white manhood suffrage between or anybody over the age of 21, any white male over the age of 21 can now vote, which means that more poor people are going to be voting and they're going to have a major sway over these elections. So people like Andrew Jackson, who's from the West, who's from Tennessee, is going to have a much better chance now at winning elections. This increased the voter turnout by 1840 to 80%, which is today unheard of, but because it's such a new thing and now people have freedoms that they hadn't experienced before, they are going out en masse to vote in these elections. This expands democracy, this universal white manhood suffrage. We also start to see nominating committees. Instead of having just a few wealthy people select who they want to run for government, we start to see nominating committees where more people are in the process of nominating who they want to run for president. This starts in 1831 with the anti-Masons. King Caucus is where you have the people, the common people, who vote for the people, the state legislatures, who then vote for the people, who are the electors, who then vote for president. So again, the common people are far away, far removed from actually voting for president. Alexis de Tocqueville, he was a French author. He wrote Democracy in America. And this idea of democracy, this idea of people being involved in government and having an influence in government, was such a new concept for people in Europe that de Tocqueville came over to America and wrote about it and called it one of the world's greatest experiments. Jacksonian Democrats are going to be in support of the common man. The Whigs, when we see Jackson run for president again in 1828, when he wins, he is going to drop the name Republican and he's going to pick up just the name Democrats. These are the current Democrats that we have today. The Whig Party are people who are going to be against Andrew Jackson. Ironically, the people against Andrew Jackson are going to call him a king, even though Jackson, during the Revolutionary War, he was a young boy, he was wounded by a British soldier who took his saber and slashed it across his face. And so Andrew Jackson hated the British, hated anything to do with the king, And so the opposition party could think of no better way to kind of needle Andrew Jackson than to call themselves the Whigs. The Whigs over in Britain were the party that opposed the king. The Whigs are really the old Federalists. They're the wealthy, they're the merchants, they're pro-business, and they are pro-national bank. Now remember, the National Bank, the first National Bank, went away just before the War of 1812. After the War of 1812, we discover that we need a new national bank, so we start the second national bank just after the War of 1812. Jacksonian Democrats claimed what principles? Possible choices here: nullification, Jeffersonian democracy, states' rights, pro-wealthy, or a strong central government. The answer here is Jeffersonian democracy. This idea that everybody has the opportunity to be involved. Jackson is much like Thomas Jefferson in that he is supportive of the common man. He is supportive of the farmers. He's supportive of these yeoman farmers. He's supportive of these poor people, which make up the majority of Americans, and who are mainly living in the South, living in the West, living in these very, very remote regions in America. King Andrew I cartoon. Oftentimes you will see critics of Andrew Jackson paint him or draw him in a cartoon as King Andrew I. Again, calling him King Andrew. Jackson advocated which of the following? States' rights, nullification, Indian rights, rotation of civil government jobs, or the federal government? The answer here is rotation of civil government jobs. Andrew Jackson starts the spoils system. He says, "To the winner goes the spoils," and it's the system where the president, once he wins, he can hand out all these really great government jobs out there. Jackson did all of the following. He moved the Indians. Remember, the Trail of Tears. This is Andrew Jackson. And the Indian Removal Act is all President Jackson. He killed the Second National Bank. We'll talk about that here in just a second with his pet banks. He got past the force bill, forcing states to follow the law, especially when we get to this new tariff, the tariff of 1828. And he also ends the nullification crisis, all of which we're going to talk about here in a couple of minutes, so I don't want to spend a whole lot of time right now. But remember, the nullification crisis really brought about by John C. Calhoun, and they are going to nullify this tariff. So hang on, the tariff of 1828. The spoil system, what is it? Jackson felt that it was the best way to avoid corruption, but it turns out to be very, very corrupt by the time we get to the mid-1800s. Whig Party ideals. So this new Whig Party, who are they? They're the old Federalists, like we said. They're pro-business, they're pro-wealthy. They believe in internal improvements. They believe in the American system set up by Henry Clay. And because remember, all these internal improvements are going to help manufacturing. They are going to help businesses be able to trade not only with foreign countries, but also trade between the Northeast and the Northwest, expanding that infrastructure. And the Whig Party supports a strong central government. Again, the old Federalist Party. In New England, who were the Whigs? Wealthy merchants, businessmen. The Tariff of Abominations, or the Tariff of 1828. John Quincy Adams raises the tariff on woolen products, and he does this to protect the woolen manufacturing in the textile industry in Massachusetts. Remember, John Quincy Adams is from Massachusetts, and so he is being pressured by the people in New England to protect the textile industry. When he does this, the South immediately, well, it doesn't rebel against it, but it certainly complains about this new tariff, because remember, anybody in the South, anybody who is not wealthy, has to pay for now higher imported goods or higher American goods. So either way, they're having to pay higher prices on things. So the South calls this the Tariff of Abominations. I believe I said maybe in the last section or section two, the Tariff of 1819 was a Tariff of Abominations. I'm sorry about that, my fault. So again, this is a big deal in 1828. And the South is ready to secede. At least South Carolina is ready to secede over this. This leads to the nullification crisis. John C. Calhoun wanted to nullify the law. Remember, nullification really starts with Thomas Jefferson and James Madison with the Kentucky and Virginia resolutions. This idea that if a state doesn't like a federal law, they can nullify that law. Then the federal government looks at it and they still don't veto that law or get rid of that law, then the nullifying state can secede and take anybody else with them that wants to secede with them, and the federal government would have to do that. Now, the federal government never agreed to this nullification idea, but it's a way for states to claim their states' rights. All right, so the characters in the nullification crisis, let's take a look at who they are. First of all, Andrew Jackson. Andrew Jackson is against nullification. There's our dog. Okay, great. Against nullification. Again, from Tennessee, as president of the United States, he is going to force the South and force South Carolina to follow to follow the law, to follow the tariff of 1828. John C. Calhoun, he is vice president of the United States under Jackson, and he is actually for nullification. He supports nullification. So here we have the vice president of the United States supporting a law that the president hates. And for other reasons as well, Jackson is going to get rid of John C. Calhoun. Threatens to actually shoot John C. Calhoun. And then Henry Clay, the great compromiser, Henry Clay, who wrote up the Compromise of 1820, the Missouri Compromise, is also now going to write up the Compromise of 1833, which does away or which solves this nullification crisis. The Compromise of 1833 is going to lower the tariff until it reaches the 1816 level. So it lowers it every single year until finally we get to the 1816 level. So Henry Clay steps in again and saves the nation from civil war. He's going to do it one more time with the Missouri Comp I'm sorry, with the Compromise of 1850. So we're going to get there. Calhoun's theory. Calhoun's theory is that if South Carolina nullifies the law, the rest of the South will follow. He is wrong. South Carolina stands alone. And so when push comes to shove, South Carolina realizes that even if they nullify this law, they are not going to be allowed to leave. In the nullification crisis, we have a debate in Congress. Daniel Webster, a senator from Massachusetts, and Robert Hayne from South Carolina. By this time, John C. Calhoun is very, very old, and he writes this speech, but he's unable to give it. And so he gets Robert Hayne to actually give the speech and speak against Daniel Webster. Henry Clay's compromise tariff, the Compromise of 1833, again, we already talked about this, lowers the tariff annually until it reaches the 1816 level. Peggy Eaton. Peggy Eaton was the wife of the Secretary of War, John Eaton. And the uppity ups in Washington, D.C., did not like Peggy Eaton because in her former life and in her younger days, she was a barmaid. She was a barmaid and she worked in a tavern, and that is not something that the upper class did. Well, Andrew Jackson, this is just the type of friend that Andrew Jackson likes. And so Andrew Jackson, partially because his own wife was so picked on during the election campaign season that she dies shortly after he's elected. And so he has kind of the soft spot for Peggy Eaton. Well, one of the people who really goes after Peggy Eaton was Mrs. Calhoun. And because of this, when we get to 1832 and Jackson's re-election, Jackson replaces John C. Calhoun with Martin Van Buren as vice president. So Calhoun is out. He goes back to the Senate and he is now senator of South Carolina. And this is where he really pushes for nullification again. Okay, specie circular. It's signed by Jackson in 1835. He says that all land must be bought with specie. Remember what we talked about with specie? Specie is either gold or silver. It's hard money. It's not soft money. Soft money is paper money that can inflate or deflate. So hard money, gold or silver, you must buy all land with hard money. What this does is it dramatically slows down the economy. It stops speculation, or at least it slows down speculation because there's hardly any money left in the money supply. What Jackson is trying to avoid, and what he has, this is kind of his past coming back to him. he loses a lot of money in the Panic of 1819. And so he figures that because there was so much speculation in 1819, he is trying to stop speculation from happening again. Another way that he's trying to get back at the banking system, Jackson hates the banking system, which is a little ironic because, of course, Jackson is on our $20 bill. He tries to destroy the Second Bank of the United States. He feels like the Second Bank of the United States, just like the First Bank of the United States, was controlled by just a few elites. And these elites were giving out loans to their friends, were really controlling the banking system, controlling the economic system for the United States. And so Jackson wants to try to destroy, and he does try to, and he does destroy the National Bank, the Second National Bank. The way he does this is by setting up pet banks. And so he creates these local state banks, which he calls pet banks, and he orders the Secretary of the Treasury, which he fires, and then he orders another Secretary of the Treasury, which he fires, because both of those guys wouldn't do it. And so he finally finds a Secretary of the Treasury, which will take the money out of the Second National Bank and put them into the pet banks, and thus destroying the Second National Bank. Greatest immediate effects of getting rid of the Second National Bank. First of all, credit is much easier to get from these pet banks. It's much easier for local farmers to get a loan from the local bank than it is to get from the federal bank in Washington, D.C. Which leads, of course, to more credit speculation. If all of a sudden you can get more money, you can use that money to buy land and hopefully that land will go up. It's also easier for these people to get loans. And whenever people can get loans, they're going to get loans in the hope of making more money. And so this again is going to lead to speculation on land. Pet banks, these are individual banks that are favorable to the Democrats. This is the Whigs are supportive of the Second National Bank because it's strengthening this, the federal government. These pet banks are really Democrat banks that are favorable to the Democratic Party. Causes of the Panic of 1837, really Jackson. Jackson, by destroying the Second National Bank, by increasing the likelihood of land speculation, by putting money into these pet banks. These pet banks make it easier to take out loans, which people then are using to speculate on land. And then these people cannot afford that, and they wind up going bankrupt and then losing their farms, losing their houses. There's also this argument with the president of the bank, a guy named Nicholas Biddle. And because of this argument, this is where Biddle calls in a lot of these loans. He deliberately tries to, and he's successful in putting the nation into another depression, the Panic of 1837. The independent treasury system. Going back to that just for a second, Andrew Jackson was asked by all these farmers to help out, and Andrew Jackson said no. Go to Nicholas Biddle, and he can help you out. And Nicholas Biddle did not. Biddle winds up getting arrested for trying to destroy the American economy. The independent treasury system. The independent treasury system is set up in 1836 by Martin Van Buren. Remember, by the time we get to the Panic of 1837 and past the Panic of 1837, Martin Van Buren has a new nickname called Martin Van Ruin. Because everybody blames him for the Panic of 1837, even though it's probably not his fault. The independent treasury system is going to operate much like the National Bank, but it's a government bank, but it's not supposed to be political. It's supposed to look out for the interests of everybody and not just the wealthy. It's also set up to pay the bills of the government. Frontier of 1830, 1840, which is not part of the frontier in 1830 and 1840. So again, we need to think about geography and we need to think about time periods. So 1830, where are Americans living? All right. Possible answers: Lexington, Kentucky; Cincinnati; Ohio; Denver, Colorado; New Orleans, Louisiana; or St. Louis, Missouri. The answer here is Denver. For the most part, Americans had not made it out to that far west by this time. Denver is considered the far west. And in the 1830s, Americans are just making it past the Mississippi River into Missouri. Missouri is really the farthest west that we're going to go. So, importance of the 1840 election. This is an election between William Henry Harrison. Remember, he is the war hero of the War of 1812, kills Tecumseh. His nickname is Tippy Canoe. And he runs against Martin Van Buren. By this time, Martin Van Buren is being called Martin Van Ruin. And so William Henry Harrison, a Whig candidate, is going to wind up winning. Everybody blames Van Buren for the Panic of 1837. This begins a string of war heroes, most of them being very ineffectual. And this is really the first modern campaign. William Henry Harrison goes around and he has political parties. He's inviting people over. He has bands playing. He has buttons made. He's handing out alcohol. In fact, one of the things that he hands out, because by this time it's Martin Van Buren is seen as kind of this uppity guy, this wealthy guy. And William Henry Harrison says, "I was born in a log cabin." Well, he really wasn't. He was, his mansion may have had a log cabin in back, but he certainly wasn't born there. But he is seen as his log cabin candidate. And because he's seen as his log cabin candidate, he has whiskey put into glass jars shaped as a log cabin. On the bottom of this is an inscription of the bottle maker. And the bottle maker was a guy named Booze. And that's where we get the word booze from. Reforms of the 1830s. 1830s and into the 1840s, there are a series of reforms, and AP loves to go back to these reforms. And we can talk about these reforms here, then we can talk about reforms in the progressive era. So pay attention to these different reforms, because more than ever before, we're going to have to start making these links. All right, reforms in the 1830s. Education reform. The main person here is Horace Mann. Horace Mann standardizes education, not only in Massachusetts, where education had been very important for a long, long time, but really throughout the United States. And so he is producing what's called McGruff readers. And in these McGruff readers, all the kids in the United States are learning the same thing the same way. So A is for Adam, B is for Bible, D is for democracy, C is for Constitution. I know I did that out of order. You'll have to live with it. All right. He also said and promoted this idea of teacher education, that teachers need to be professionally trained in order to teach. The Second Great Awakening is also a part of this reform movement. I remember the First Great Awakening, we have Jonathan Edwards. Here we have the Second Great Awakening. This happens throughout the United States, but it really is focused on New York and tent meetings along the Erie Canal in New York. In fact, the Erie Canal area is known as the burned over district because of a couple different things. First of all, as people get excited and as they're singing and praying and being on fire for God, that's exactly what they're being called. Hey, you're being on fire for God, and this is the burned over district. But a little more realistically, what's happening is in these tent meetings, lots of people are in these tent meetings, and invariably one of the lanterns gets tipped over and lights the entire tent on fire. And so we have these fires up and down the Erie Canal, and so the burned over district. All right, so the Second Great Awakening is really an intellectual is really fighting against the intellectual movement. The deists and intellectuals are going to disagree with Second Great Awakening. They are going to call the Second Great Awakening as too emotional. They said it's breaking away from traditional religion. Charles Finney is the major speaker of the time. And again, going up and down the Erie Canal, it's a great way to spread your message to a large group of people. Social issues of new religions. We see all sorts of new Protestant religions pop up. We see the Millerites, the Seventh-day Adventists, the Shakers, and the Mormons starting to pop up in the 1830s, 1840s. Unitarianism. Unitarianism believed in a moral authority. They believed in Jesus being that moral authority, but they did not necessarily believe in the divinity or the deity of Jesus. And so these people are intellectuals, and they're trying to mesh intellectualism with religion. The kids of these Unitarians are going to be the Transcendentalists that we'll talk about a little bit later on. We also have utopian societies, societies such as Brook Farm and Oneida, and people breaking away from the major cities and trying to set up this perfectionist community. Later on in the 1960s, we're going to call these places communes, places to try to develop a perfect society. In the early 1800s, feminists and the goals, or what were the goals of feminists in the early 1800s, in the early 19th century, they supported rights. Women's rights were trying to push for property rights, women being able to control their own property and not have that property go from their husband's property to their husband's property. Or if their husband died, they should be able to control their own property. Which movement were most antebellum women involved in? First of all, let's talk about antebellum. Antebellum simply means before the Civil War. So it's the 30 years before the Civil War, from about 1820, 1830 until 1860. Okay, so which movement were most antebellum women involved in? Pacifism, temperance, women's suffrage, workers' rights, immigrants. Well, women's suffrage is going to be a little bit later. Pacifism, not really. Temperance is going to be the answer here, because remember, drinking alcohol had a major effect on the lives of the families, and women have always been the major protector of the families in many cases. And so women, this idea that men go out, they drink, and not only are they using up the family income, but then they tend to be violent when they come home and they beat the kids and they beat the wives. So temperance is very important for these early women, this early women, women's movement. Seneca Falls Convention, very, very important. 1848, the two women here are Lucretia Mott and Elizabeth Cady Stanton. They write a document called the Declaration of Sentiments, which is based on the Declaration of Independence. Of course, the Declaration of Independence says that all men are equal. Declaration of Sentiments says that all men and women are equal. Now, let's not get carried away. Certainly, we're not talking about Indians. We're not talking about blacks. But certainly, all white men and all white women are equal. This is really the first women's convention where people are starting to talk about things like suffrage. So Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Lucretia Mott are kind of the forerunners of this suffrage movement. Legal status of women in the early 1800s, they had no legal status. Their legal status was dependent upon the men in their lives, their father's status, or their husband's status. Past that, if their husband died, then they had to move back with their family, so, or with a brother. So women generally did not have legal status in the 1800s. Struggle for the right to vote really started with the abolitionist movement. As women are working to get slavery to be abolished, they start thinking, why are we doing all this work for trying to free slaves, which is a good thing, but yet we are going to wind up worse off than slaves. And so the suffrage movement really begins with the abolitionist movement. If you ever see a quote from Lucretia Mott, you always must think about Seneca Falls. The same thing with Dorothea Dix. Elizabeth Cady Stanton. Either of those two women automatically tie them to Seneca Falls and the Declaration of Sentiments. American Colonization Society and this organization argued that we should buy freedom, we should buy slaves freedom, and then send those slaves over to Liberia and Africa. So Liberia was set up as a place to send former slaves. Now a couple thousand former slaves are sent to Liberia, but that's about it. And we discover that this is going to cost a lot of money in order to do this, and it's just not going to work. Abolitionism. I had widespread feminist support. Their idea is, hey, listen, if we can get rights for blacks, our rights will follow. And eventually, it's going to take a lot longer than anybody had planned, but eventually that's going to be the case. Their goals were to abolish slavery, obviously, for abolition. And why do they break into factions? Because you have the rise of middle class, upper class people. And even in the North, people are not real sure at first that we want to abolish slavery, because if we abolish slavery, then all those former slaves could come up into the factories and start working in factories, reducing the wages for workers. So not even in the North are they really sure that they want to abolish slavery. The gag rule. Slavery, the issue of slavery keeps coming up in Congress, and every time it does, it turns into a big argument. Sometimes to the point of violence. They had to nail down desks on the floor of the Senate and the House of Representatives. People were strapping guns to their hips. People were bringing canes onto the floor. And oftentimes there were physical fights on the floor of the Senate and the House of Representatives. And so there was a rule in the 1830s, this gag rule that said you cannot talk about the issue of slavery. The big opponent of the gag rule is our good friend John Quincy Adams. After John Quincy Adams is done being president, he winds up going back to Congress and serving out the rest of his life in Congress. And he is a big proponent of free speech. And he said there should be nothing in Congress that we cannot discuss. And so he opposed this idea of a gag rule. All right, William Lloyd Garrison. Of course, William Lloyd Garrison's newspaper is called The Liberator. It's an abolitionist newspaper, and he is calling for the immediate and uncompensated emancipation of slaves. He said, we need to emancipate slaves right now. We also need to emancipate slaves without compensating anybody, without giving money to these slave owners. This really starts in the 1830s and goes up until really the Civil War. Frederick Douglass. Frederick Douglass was one of many runaway slaves, but he's probably one of the most prominent runaway slaves. Frederick Douglass makes it to the North. He turns out to be the preeminent abolitionist speaker. In fact, so much so that during the Civil War, Frederick Douglass was the first person invited to a presidential inauguration for Abraham Lincoln in 1864. Dorothea Dix, and once again, we are still in this idea of reforms in the 1830s. So Dorothea Dix, her reform was prisons and reforming how we handle mentally ill people, back then called the insane. Back then, if you were considered insane, you were sent to prison, which did nothing to help your mental capacity. And so she proposed to reform prisons, to make them a little more humanitarian, and to also separate the insane into separate mental hospitals so they can get the help that they need. Other reformers at the time, Dorothea Dix, the insane, Harry Beecher Stowe, of course, abolition, Lucretia Mott, women's rights. The only one that doesn't match here is Brigham Young, abolition. Brigham Young, of course, the leader of the Mormons as they're moving out west to Utah, and they had no issues, or abolition was not really their main thing. The cult of domesticity starts in the 1830s. This idea that women's role is in the home, and it's a very important role in the home. And during the Revolutionary War, remember the women's role in the Revolutionary War is to raise good patriots. Well, this is kind of a spin-off of that, in that women's role is in the home. Her job is to make the home a place of refuge. She should be concerned with what color the drapes are. She should be concerned with what meals are being made at home, just making it a place of rest. What kind of recipes are new, the newest fashions, anything like that is up to the women to kind of make that home as pleasant as possible. Antebellum cities. Antebellum cities are places of merchants, places of business, places of factories, and as we get closer and closer to the Civil War, we have a lot of these cities getting very, very big. And of course, these cities are, they have a lot of stuff going on, they have a lot of factories going on, they are the ones that are going to be able to produce a lot of stuff for the during the Civil War. Which means, for the North, this is going to help out the North quite a bit, because they're able to produce stuff. The South hardly has any manufacturing cities at all. The main manufacturing city in the South is going to be Atlanta. And during the Civil War, that gets burned to the ground. Home as a refuge versus a workplace. We've already touched on this already. This gets back to the cult of domesticity. Oh, I think I skipped over this. And you might see a cartoon of a woman all dressed up in a nice looking dress, and they're playing chess, and everything just looks perfect in the house. And this is the idea that the house is a place of refuge, it's a place of rest, and not a place of everything going crazy. Just did Antebellum Cities, American Art. American art, antebellum art is very nationalistic. It's very patriotic. It's very pro-American. It's showing all the great things that America has to offer. It's in the 1830s. It's showing the canals. It's showing the national road. It's starting to show railroads as we start to build railroads, especially in the east and northeast. And so it's very pro-American as far as what we're painting. We are breaking away from European art. Usually we are, up until the 1830s, we are painting European landscapes and you know, everything in Europe is terrific, European buildings and landmarks and monuments and stuff. And now we're breaking away from that, and we're being very much pro-American. The Hudson River School of Art is promoting this. This is where artists, this is the main place where artists are going to learn how to paint. And they are learning, they're really focused on people, American people, and American landscapes. Hudson River School of Art. Later on, we're gonna talk about the Ashcan School of Art, so make sure you keep those two separate. Antebellum art, antebellum art was possible choices, expressionism, existentialism, romanticism, or pragmatism. Let's talk about a couple of these words. First of all, expressionism is using very dark colors, as a word might say, very expressive. Existentialism talks about literature, so that does not deal with art. Romanticism, we'll come back to it here in just a second. Pragmatism, we've talked about pragmatism before. It's important that you know that word. Pragmatism means practicality, what works. And that is not really the focus of art in the 1830s and 1840s. Romanticism is really the focus of art in the 1830s, 1840s. Again, very pro-American, very idealistic American, very a romantic view of life. James Fenimore Cooper, his book, Last of the Mohicans, he's the first to use the American frontier in American literature. And so, again, instead of literature being focused on Europe, now we're starting to see literature focused on America. Cooper's writing had American characters. List of writers, who was the poet laureate or the king of all living poets? Wheatley, Thoreau, Emerson, Poe, or Whitman? You have to know that Whitman was the preeminent poet of his day, so Walt Whitman. All right, let's take a look at different artists or different writers and their books. First of all, Melville writes Moby Dick. Walt Whitman writes Leaves of Grass. Edgar Allan Poe, The Raven. James Fenimore Cooper, Last of the Mohicans. Nathaniel Hawthorne is The Scarlet Letter. Thoreau is Walden, and Emerson is American Scholar. So AP loves to go back to those authors. Make sure you know those authors. And many of those authors are going to be considered transcendentalists, especially Thoreau and Emerson. All right, nationalistic movement of literature. Again, American ideas, American themes. Pro-America, very idealistic view of what America is. Emerson is a transcendentalist. The effect is to celebrate America, to encourage the arts, to encourage people to kind of express themselves through different means and mediums. Transcendentalists, they are inspired by nature. I always get this view of transcendentalists as sitting around a lake, you know, Emerson or Thoreau, sitting around a lake, and with bongo drums and maybe dreadlocks and you know, complaining against consumer culture and complaining against their parents. And they're sitting there and they're going, oh, my life is terrible. Oh, my parents are terrible. Oh, society is terrible. Let's go plant some flowers. And I know that's not what they did, but they're really focusing in on the issues of America and thinking, how can we make these things better? And so there's a lot of comparisons between these transcendentalists and going to the 1950s, the beatniks. There's going to be a lot of those same themes going on, complaining about this consumerist culture. Group of ideas in literature as a protest against the general state of culture, especially intellectualism. We're going to, you know, all these uppity-ups that think that they know everything, and these transcendentalists are teaching everybody a new way to think, a new way to look at society. Who are the main people here? Thoreau and Emerson. It is not a social movement. It is trying to teach a lower class, though, a different way to look at society. All right, Thoreau and civil disobedience. He believed in passive protests, and again, we can attach this to other people, especially Martin Luther King Jr. In the 1960s. So this idea of passive protests. Don't pay your taxes, because if you pay your taxes, that means it's going to the government. The government's going to use that for the military. The military is going to use that to gain more land. If we gain more of that land, that's going to be more slave land. More slave land means more slaves, and that's immoral. So we need to not pay our taxes, because eventually that's going to lead to immorality in our country. Why did the South have a diversified economy? This goes all the way back to the early days of colonization to 1612, when we start planting tobacco. The South, by 1820 now, is almost entirely cotton. We have moved away for the most part from tobacco, although that's still there. Now it's cotton, 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 and so much money is being made out of cotton, or made because of cotton, that cotton is actually called King Cotton. It runs everything in the South. It runs all the social aspects of the South. It runs the political aspects of the South. It runs the economic aspects of the South. So everything in the South is run because of cotton. And that's why it doesn't have a diversified economy, because why are you going to spend all your money creating a factory that may not work if you can just go out and grow cotton and make all sorts of money? Now, of course, this is going to lead the South to become more independent, or more dependent on the North and more dependent on England. As both the North and England are buying more and more cotton, that's the only place where the South can sell their cotton to. All right, J.D.B. DeBow, we talked about Hinton Helper. We'll talk about him here in just a minute. DeBow is saying basically the same thing, that the South needs to industrialize. Hinton Helper says that the South needs to diversify their economy. They need to be doing different things. That Southerners are getting too lazy, depending upon slave labor, and the South needs to diversify. So both of these people, DeBow and Helper, are saying essentially the same thing. Slaves in coming to America lost their freedom, lost their culture, lost their language, lost their religion, lost their obviously individuality. How did free blacks gain their freedom? Legally, they gained their freedom in a couple different ways. First of all, they could buy their freedom. In one case, Denmark Vesey actually is allowed to play the lottery. He wins the lottery, and with his winnings, he buys his freedom. It could also be given to slaves for lifelong service, or maybe you become close to the slave owner's family, which did happen from time to time, and upon the death of the owner, that owner could free their slaves. Or a heroic act. If a slave winds up saving a family member of the slave owner's family, then the slave owner could grant that person freedom. Okay, slaves from Virginia were sold to the Southwest. As we get into the 1830s, the 1840s, as we're starting to move into the Southwest, especially in places like Alabama, Mississippi, Louisiana, we're opening up more slave land. Now remember, we can't bring any more slaves in to the country from mainly the Caribbean, but we can transfer slaves. We can sell slaves from one place to another. And the place that had really the most slaves is Virginia. And so they were selling slaves to the South, to the Southeast, and into the South, what we know to back then as the Southwest, Louisiana. How did the cotton gin affect the South? We talked about this, I think it was just in the last number three review, that the cotton gin dramatically changes the life of slaves. Instead of spending your life on the porch, in the shade, picking seeds out of cotton, now your life is in the field, picking cotton and growing cotton, cultivating cotton. And that's what your life was now in the hot, hot Georgia sun. And so the cotton gin, you only needed one or two or maybe three or four slaves to run the cotton gin, depending upon how large the cotton gin was. All the rest of the slaves now are out in the fields. Before the cotton gin, your plantation was limited to the amount of cotton that you could clean. After the cotton gin, Now your plantation is limited to the size of how much cotton can you pick, how much cotton can you grow. And that's why we, by the way, we need more cotton land. Who was the South's major trading partner before the Civil War? The British, and even during the Civil War. The South is trading with the British because the British, still the world's leader in textile industry, even more so than the North, New England states. And so the South is very closely tied to the British, to the point where the British almost come in on the side of the South. If the South would have won at Gettysburg during the Civil War, the British probably would have come in on the side of the South. The slave trade increased in the United States because the cotton market increased. The British textile industry got bigger, the New England textile industry got bigger, and so we need more cotton. More cotton means we need to grow more cotton, we need to find more land. And by the way, the slave trade did not increase because slaves were easier to buy. In fact, they were harder to buy, they became more valuable, and more valuable means that it costs more money to actually buy a slave. The nature of slavery, its effects on blacks, obviously the denial of freedom, the effect on whites. Whites actually become lazy in the South because if you have slaves working for you, there's no reason to do any work. And so whites used to be the overseers. Now they're not. They used to actually work on their own plantations. Now they don't. And so whites in the South are not really encouraged to expand the economy, to do different things, to create things that will diversify the economy. Slave owners, it's important to remember that a minority of the Southern population actually owned slaves. Only about 25% of the population owned slaves. And of that, a very small fraction owned more than five. If you owned slaves at all, it was usually one, two, three, four, or five slaves. It was certainly not more than 20. There were few very, very large plantations, but these large plantations could have a couple hundred slaves. The price of slaves in 1860. By the way, everybody, this is our dog Rosie, named after Rosie the Riveter, so in case you care. All right. The price of slaves by 1860, a price for a male teenage slave was $1,800, which was an exorbitant amount of money back then. It cost $100 for a baby who would be a slave and then would grow into, of course, being a teenager and then being an adult. Slaves were encouraged to be happy as they could be being slaves. They were encouraged to be married because, of course, if slaves got married, that would increase the chances of having babies. Then those babies, of course, would also be slaves on those plantations. The nature of the slave family, they were dependent upon their extended family because so often you could expect to be sold away from your plantation or have somebody that you know sold away from your plantation at least two or three times in your lifetime. So if it's you being sold away from your family, even if it's you're sold away from your spouse, now maybe you're going to a plantation and maybe you have a second cousin there or you have a distant uncle or aunt that lives on that plantation. So that extended family for slaves is very, very important. Were slaves a good investment? No, not really. Sharecroppers turned out to be a much better investment, a much better way to grow crops. And we're gonna find that out after the Civil War when a lot of these former slaves turn into sharecroppers. And now that they have an incentive to grow crops, as still cotton in the South. Hinton Helper, The Impending Crisis of the South, very important book. You need to know Hinton Helper and The Impending Crisis of the South. Again, Helper, who is a Southerner, by the way, is arguing that slavery is ruining the Southern economy, that the South is too dependent on slavery, that the South has not diversified their economy. The Southern justification for slavery, otherwise known as apologists for slavery, they say, hey, we have a history behind us. There were slaves going back to the ancient Greeks, to the ancient Rome. So history has seen slaves forever. Also, the Bible doesn't condemn slavery. Jesus never said anything about slavery, and so if Jesus didn't say anything against it, he must have been okay with it. The belief back then was that blacks were naturally inferior to whites. And a lot of this had to do with their diet. Their diet causing sometimes mental capacity or slower mental capacities. And sometimes it was an act by slaves to just move as slow as possible. Other times it was due to lack of a nutritional diet. And they also argued that wage earners in the North were much worse off. That wage slaves in the North, that these poor people that worked in factories would get paid just pennies a day, and then they would live in poverty. They would have to support themselves. They would have to have their own food. They would have to buy their own clothes. And slave owners argued that they actually took care of slaves better than factory owners took care of their workers. Why did the South condone slavery? They said it was their way of life, their peculiar institution. And you might see that phrase come up. So the peculiar institution of slavery. How do slaves increase in number after the end of foreign trade? I remember after 1808, we're going to end the intercontinental slave trade. And so we have to depend on ourselves to increase the number of slaves. That's going to be done through natural reproduction. And one of the reasons why slave owners encourage their slaves to be married. Some ways that slaves resisted. The most dramatic way is that they would run away. The more common way is that they would be very passive. They would do what's called the Sambo Act, where they would shuffle along and kind of scratch their head and pretend not to understand what's going on and work as slowly as possible. Rebellions were very, very rare. If a rebellion happened, like the Nat Turner Rebellion that we're going to talk about here in just a second, those rebellions are going to be put down very, very violently to make an example out of these rebellion leaders. Importance of Negro spirituals. Whites saw blacks, slaves singing in the fields and thought, oh, isn't that nice? The slaves are so happy picking cotton that they're singing and they're happy and they're just happy to be out there and they're singing their hearts away. Well, it turns out that Negro spirituals is what they're called, is a way to express their sorrow and the depression that they're in because of their lives that they're experiencing. And so it is these Negro spirituals in the South. This is not a way to experience or to express how happy they are, just the opposite. Nat Turner, we just touched on him a second ago. He led one of the only successful rebellions, and when we define successful, we mean killing whites. He went from village, or not village to village, but small town to small town, farm to farm, killing every white person he could find. Eventually, the rebellion is put down. Nat Turner and his followers are hanged. 30 people are convicted. 18 people are hanged. And so this rebellion is put down very violently. And by the way, the Turner Rebellion was in Virginia. Before the Civil War, most white males in the South were tenants, yeomen, plantation owners, or factory workers. Most white males in the South, remember, so that automatically takes away factory workers. There's hardly any factories in the South. Most people are not plantation owners. Tenants, that's too early yet. That's really after the Civil War. And so the answer is yeoman farmers. These yeoman farmers, these are subsistence farmers. These are we go back to colonial days and indentured servants, these are the people that are owning a small piece of land and they are growing just enough food for their family. So they are poor farmers who are just making it for themselves and their family. What is a yeoman farmer? A subsistence farmer, they own their own land. Squatters are somebody different. Squatters are actually people who kind of hide out on somebody else's land. The yeoman farmer probably doesn't even know that they're out there. These people are just living on the land that and nobody has discovered them yet. Okay, we only have one collection of dates, so here we go. The Claremont, the first steamboat, sails in 1807. Number two, the end to foreign importation of slaves, 1808. Number three, the Tariff of Abominations is 1828. Also called the real name of it is the Tariff of 1828. Number four, the South Carolina Exposition and Protest. This is where John C. Calhoun comes up with this idea of nullification. That's in 1828. Number five, Nat Turner's Rebellion, 1831. Number six, The Liberator is first published in 1831. Number seven, The Force Bill, 1833, forcing South Carolina to follow the law, to follow this tariff. Number eight, Seneca Falls Convention, 1848. And I believe that's all. Okay, so that does it for review number four. We'll come back and do review number five.